Good afternoon. It's lovely to see you all. A very warm welcome to Chester Cathedral from me, the Dean, and the chapter here. We gather on this day, an important day for colleagues who are reflecting on their ministries and offering themselves to the service of God as readers, as pastoral workers and as lay pioneers, some entering these ministries for the first time, some transferring, and some ministries that we're giving thanks to God for as well. Welcome to all of you who come to pray with friends and with colleagues on this significant day. Just a couple of simple instructions that I need to give you before we begin. As a society, we're in an ambiguous period, wearing masks, sometimes not wearing masks, others socially distancing, sometimes not at others. Please do be mindful of one another. There will be friends amongst us who need to keep their distance more than others. We suggest that when you are moving about the cathedral from now on, please put a mask on. And if you want to sing, we ask you to wear a mask whilst singing. But if, when you are seated for comfort, you need to take the mask off, feel free to do so. Always, though, being mindful of those who are around you. When at the end of the service we leave, once again, please do your best not to create big huddles, but maintain some social distance. They're the things I needed to say to you, but most important of all, hoping that you find this a good occasion to pray for one another, are able to meet with the living God and hold the faces of those whose journeys we know something of, hold them before God and pray for his blessing upon them. I'm going to leave you with a little quiet now for prayer and to call upon God's Spirit for yourself. Shortly the bell will sound, at which point please stand and we will sing together the opening hymn.
Thank you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There is one body and one spirit. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. Peace be with you. Thank you. Please do be seated. Can I add my welcome to that of the Dean? It's fantastic. I think this is the fullest service I've been in since I've been bishop here in the diocese, and that's been over a year. So welcome to you all. Welcome very especially if you are not used to being in a place like this. I think God is particularly pleased that you are here today. Please don't let any of our Church of England oddness, because there is a little bit of that around, make you feel uncomfortable. If you don't know you need to stand, it's absolutely fine. And if the children make noise, think of it like birdsong in the background, a reminder that God is good, God is alive, and he's here with us. So you are welcome, whether you're here in the building or whether you are with us online. Welcome to those of you who are being licensed today as readers. Those are people who are able to take services and do all sorts of ministry in the name of the church, but are called to a slightly different ministry to vicars, in case you're wondering what readers is, because most of us learn to read when we are little. Welcome to those of you being licensed as pastoral workers. Your ministry will so often be invisible. It will be behind closed doors. And yet the Lord will be with you as you reach out with his hands of love and grace. And welcome to two of you being licensed as pioneer ministers, those called to think with imagination about how we share the love of God beyond those constraints that we so often allow ourselves to be held in. We are licensing lay ministers, and you complete the ministry of the church. You help us expand it and extend it. For one of our Church of England oddnesses is we make people think all too often that it's only about the vicars, and it really isn't. There is so much ministry that needs to be done by others. Just this morning, I did Chester Park Run for the first time. So if I need to have a seat, you'll understand why. There was somebody who used to work for the diocese, and so I snuck up behind this individual and I said, "Morning, so and so." They turned round and said, "Oh God!" And I said, "No, it's just the bishop." We need all sorts and conditions of people serving Christ, those who wear dresses and those who don't. So you too are not off the hook, for the ministry of the whole people of God is what we are celebrating this afternoon. Particular welcome to Bishops Sam, Julie, and Graham. Bishops Sam and Julie, you may not have met yet, but are the new bishops of Stockport and Birkenhead. I did get that the right way around, didn't I? And it's just a great joy, really, to share in ministry with you. So welcome to each of you as we gather in this holy place and respond to God's goodness. Let's keep a moment's quiet, and then Bishops Julie and Sam will lead us on in the service.
Today in this place of prayer, we gather with joy to celebrate the ministries of those who are to be licensed as pastoral workers, readers, and lay pioneers, and to continue to support those who are moving to serve in a new parish.
Pastoral workers are called to work in partnership with the clergy and others in caring for people both within and beyond the family of the church. In the Gospel, Jesus tells us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for him, and that it is by our love for one another that others will know that we are his disciples. Those who are to be admitted as pastoral workers today will serve their communities in a variety of ways, preparing families for baptism and couples for marriage, and supporting them in the years that follow, visiting the sick and housebound, comforting the bereaved and lonely. By God's grace, they will proclaim the good news of Christ's kingdom by the generosity of their care and the integrity of their lives.
Readers are called to serve the Church of God and to work together with clergy and other ministers. They are to lead public worship, to preach and teach the Word of God, to assist at the Eucharist, and to share in pastoral and evangelistic work. As authorized lay ministers, they are to encourage the ministries of all God's people, as the Spirit distributes gifts among us all. They are called to help the whole church to participate in God's mission to the world.
Lay pioneers are called to work with others to reach out to people who have traditionally been outside the orbit of the church. They are called to share the love of Christ by developing a wide variety of creative and innovative approaches to mission and developing them through to fruition. That might include using a shared or common interest or hobby to form small group missional communities or inquirers groups. By their gifts of imagination and creativity, they spread the good news of Jesus out to the world.
And we also come this afternoon to give thanks, to give deep, real thanks for those who have served God faithfully and now come to mark this milestone stage in their lives and ministries.
So let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer, which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry each may serve you in holiness and truth to the glory of your name. Through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the book of Zechariah, chapter 8, beginning to read at the 14th verse. For thus says the Lord of hosts, just as I am purposed to bring disaster upon you when your ancestors provoked me to wrath, and I did not relent, says the Lord of hosts, so again I have purposed in these days to do good to Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. Do not be afraid. These are the things that you shall do. Speak the truth to one another. Render in your gates judgments that are true and make for peace. Do not devise evil in your hearts against one another, and love no false oaths. For all these are things that I hate, says the Lord. The word of the Lord of hosts came to me, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, the fast of the fourth month, and the fast of the fifth, and the fast of the seventh, and the fast of the tenth shall be seasons of joy and gladness and cheerful festivals for the house of Judah. Therefore, love truth and peace. Thus says the Lord of hosts, people shall yet come, the inhabitants of many cities. The inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, Come, let us go to entreat the favor of the Lord and to seek the Lord of hosts. I myself am going. Many peoples and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem and to entreat the favor of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, In those days 10 men from nations of every language shall take hold of a Jew, grasping his garment and saying, Let us go with you, for we have heard that God is with you. Here ends the first reading.
A reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 20, beginning to read at the 19th verse. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have yet come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Here ends the second reading.
Today's gospel begins with scared disciples locked away in a house. Their leader had been executed on the cross. They feared that the Roman and religious authorities would come after them for being associated with Jesus. Their messianic hopes had dissolved into survival tactics. They were confused, afraid, and in hiding. John's Gospel records that just that morning, that day, Mary Magdalene had reported to them that she had seen the risen Christ. But clearly, this was going to either need mansplaining, or they just had to see it for themselves. So there they were, hiding, when out of nowhere, Jesus came and stood amongst them. Now, I'm going to be very traditional and talk about three things that Jesus brought to those first disciples. Three things that will be easy to remember because they all begin with the same letter, a letter that Bishop Sam guessed on the way in, the letter P. Three things that are essential to our discipleship, our following of Jesus, our vocation. The first is peace. I don't suppose the disciples expected that. After all, they had mostly abandoned Jesus. One of their number had betrayed him. Peter had denied knowing Jesus. They must have feared that they were in for a right telling off. And perhaps they also imagined that Jesus had come back to set things straight with the authorities and the Roman oppressors. Surely he would come in judgment to punish. This would be the victory they had all been waiting for. But no, just peace be with you. Because we know how the story runs, because we read it backwards from where we are today, through many centuries of church doctrine and teaching, we forget how utterly flummoxing it must have been at the time. And if we're not careful, we can miss the grace in this resurrection appearance, the unimaginable grace demonstrated by an almighty God made vulnerable by a crucified Messiah, grace that comes in peace when punishment would seem a more just desert.
I want those of you who are newly licensed today and those who are moving to new phases of ministry or locations to remember this grace and the unexpected peace that Christ brings, the peace that calms both our petty anxieties and our deepest fears, the peace that you will need in pastoral encounters if you are to be the non-anxious presence, the peace that you will need in your life and ministry when circumstances seem overwhelming, the peace that will enable you neither to crumble nor to lash out when you face criticism, the peace that flows from a confidence in God's love and mercy and grace. Now for the second thing. After coming in peace, Jesus gave them power. Verse 22 tells us that when he said, "Peace be with you," he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." This is John's version of Pentecost. This action gave Jesus' followers the spiritual power and discernment they would need to fulfill their mission. It was to transform them from being lost, fearful, and bereft, ultimately into a commissioned and inspired group of disciples. Without that gift of the Spirit, the friends and followers of Jesus would have lacked the strength, courage, and vision that they would need. And so it is with all of us. We need the inspiration and power from God. Minister in your own strength and you will fail. Do your own thing and you will neglect to build what God requires. You will be distracted from the work of the kingdom of God into your own vanity projects or well-intentioned schemes. Rely entirely on your own resources, and you may well find yourself stranded high and dry. So I urge you to wait on the inspiration and guidance that the Holy Spirit gives, taking the time needed to continually, repeatedly discern what God wants from you in ministry and to draw on God for your strength. Which brings me to the third thing that Jesus brought into that locked room. Purpose. As my Father has sent me, so I send you. They were to be sent out to do God's bidding, with mouths to proclaim the good news, hands to do the work of the kingdom, and hearts to love, just as God loves. It's tempting to leave it at that, but there is the tricky verse 23 to deal with. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. This sounds like a responsibility that few of us would want. So often we deal with this verse by clericalizing it, so it becomes about the role of a priest to declare God's forgiveness, to proclaim the absolution, or we use this verse to justify the idea that the church has been set up by Jesus as some sort of moral watchdog. But I'm not sure that is what is being said here. In John's Gospel, Jesus talks about sin as unbelief, the unwillingness or incapacity to recognize that God is made manifest, revealed in Christ. So perhaps Jesus is saying that through the Spirit, his followers will be empowered to go out and bear witness to who Christ is and what he has done, so that people might be set free or released from their unbelief. Basically, if you go out in the power of the Spirit and bear witness, then people will be free. But if you don't, they will not experience all that Jesus offers. I suppose all of this is really discipleship, following Jesus. This is what being a member of Christ's church is all about. Accepting the peace and forgiveness that Jesus brings, receiving the power of the Holy Spirit, and then going out into our daily lives in that power to work for the purposes of the kingdom of God and to see people live life in all its fullness, just as Jesus promised. Simple. But what about Thomas, I hear you cry? Tell us about Thomas. Well, for those who hate long sermons, you'll be relieved to know that this is for another preach on a different occasion. Suffice it to say that Thomas and the other disciples were surprisingly reluctant to go out of the locked house that they met in, just as we can stubbornly be resistant to going out of our churches. So remember, peace, power, purpose. We, just like those first followers, are sent out there.
Bishop Mark, I present to you these candidates to be admitted as readers.
Thank you, Vivian, and not just for your presentation, but for all the work you do caring for our readers and pastoral workers, and Jenny and Liz, for all the work that you and so many others have done in preparing them for this day. The investment that you have made is like seeds which have been planted and which will bear fruit. Vivian, have they made the declaration of assent and thereby affirmed and declared their belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness? Have they also made the declaration of obedience to the bishop and the declaration which must be made before a reader is licensed?
They have. Bishop Mark, I present to you this candidate to be admitted as a pastoral worker.
Thank you. Has she made the declaration of assent and thereby affirmed and declared her belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness? Has she also made the declaration of obedience to the bishop?
She has.
Thank you.
Bishop Mark, I present to you these candidates to be admitted as lay pioneers.
Thank you. Have they made the declaration of assent and thereby affirmed and declared their belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness? Have they also made the declaration of obedience to the bishop?
They have.
Liz and Jenny, are these women and men of Christian character, well versed in the Holy Scriptures and the doctrines of our faith?
They are.
Have they been sufficiently prepared for the duties of this office?
They have.
Now, in order that we may be satisfied that you are ready to begin the ministry of a reader, a pastoral worker, or a lay pioneer, you must answer the questions we put to you. Do you believe that God is calling you to this ministry? Will you be faithful in leading the people of God in worship and in preaching the word to them? Will you be diligent in prayer, in reading Holy Scripture, and in all studies that will deepen your faith and fit you to bear witness to the truth of the gospel? Will you endeavor to fashion your life according to the way of Christ? Will you promote unity, peace, and love in the church and in the world, and especially among those whom you will serve? Will you work closely with your colleagues in ministry and encourage the gifts of others? I am so pleased to hear it and so thrilled to be working in partnership with you. Please do turn to face the congregation. My friends, coffee could come earlier than we expected to, because this question really matters. Brothers and sisters, these men and women have been chosen for the offices of reader, pastoral worker, or lay pioneer. Will you uphold and encourage them in their ministry?
We will.
Will you continue to pray for them?
We will.
Thank you. Let me again just pause at that moment and note what a commitment you have given. No ministry is ever undertaken alone. And I always say this at this point in these services, and just occasionally hear subsequently of cards or messages that have been sent. I've heard of just one today. Let me encourage you as you go home to ask the Lord, what is it that I am praying, particularly for whomever it is that you have come to support? And why not send them an email or a text? Or if you're old-fashioned like me, why not get out an ink pen and write it on a postcard and stick it in the post? Just in order that these, our sisters and brothers, might create something of a scrapbook of prayers prayed over them as they take this step of faith in this day. Can I invite those who are incumbents of those being licensed to stand and to respond to these questions? Will you work closely with your colleagues and encourage them to use their gifts and develop their ministry? Will you commend them to the people amongst whom they will minister? Thank you. Please do be seated. Let's keep a moment to pray, and then I will lead us in this prayer. God, our Father, Lord of all the world, we thank you that through your Son you have called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry each may be an instrument of your love. And give to your servants now to be admitted to the office of reader, pastoral worker, or lay pioneer, the needful gifts of grace. Grant them wisdom and understanding in their reading and proclamation of your holy word, and keep them in all holiness through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Helen Byrne, to be admitted as a reader.
Helen, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Elizabeth Cooper Clark, to be admitted as a reader.
Elizabeth, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Simon Eardley, to be admitted as a reader.
Simon, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Stephen Eccleston, to be admitted as a reader.
Stephen, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Alison Hunter Johnston, to be admitted as a reader.
Alison, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Lindsay Lawrence, to be admitted as a reader.
Lindsay, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Richard Lewis, to be admitted as a reader.
Richard, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Graham Morris, to be admitted as a reader.
Graham, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Edward Newman, to be admitted as a reader.
Edward, I admit you as a reader in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jane Fisher, to be admitted as a pastoral worker.
Jane, I admit you as a pastoral worker in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Caroline Bishop, to be admitted as a lay pioneer.
Caroline, I admit you as a lay pioneer in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Alice Price, to be admitted as a lay pioneer.
Alice, I admit you as a lay pioneer in the Church of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, all those who have been admitted are receiving their licenses. Take authority to exercise the ministry to which you are called and to which you are now licensed in this diocese. Receive this license as your authority to serve, and may God richly bless you and his world in your ministry. Amen.
Readers transferring to the diocese. Jeanette Howe.
Jeanette, welcome.
Abigail Ogier. Hilary Savage. Lindsay Tanner.
For those who don't get the joke, Lindsay is my wife. Not that that's a joke.
Readers transferring within the diocese. Anne Draper.
Thank you.
Rita Waters. Jill Williams.
Jill, welcome. And Charlie, welcome. Those of us in dog collars need to stick together.
Unfortunately, I'm not one.
We do double acts. We can be booked later.
Pastoral worker transferring within the diocese, Joanna Whittle.
Welcome. Thank you. So to those who are transferring into the diocese, I say welcome. Welcome to this part of God's kingdom. Welcome to our fellowship. Welcome in Christ's name. And to each of you, I say take authority to exercise the office to which you are called and to which you are now relicensed in this diocese. Amen. Now, those who are newly licensed as readers, pastorals, and lay, pastoral workers and lay pioneers, please will you stand? And if you'll turn to face your brothers and sisters, I present to you your newly licensed readers, pastoral workers, and lay pioneers.
We welcome you.
Let's give them a big round of applause. Who have transferred, can I also say you are also welcome, and we celebrate all that God has done and will do through you as well. Let's stand and sing together. be seated. This is the moment to watch the precentor's face because the bishop is about to go off piste. If you are a licensed lay minister of any kind and you're able and willing, would you just stand for us, please? For today is not, that means readers, pastoral workers, any licensed evangelists we still have in the diocese, licensed pioneers. I can see a whole lot of readers who are not standing. If you're willing to do so, don't forget that thing about due obedience to the bishop, for goodness sake. This is a service not just where we welcome newly licensed readers or transferring readers, but also, I hope, for you, a time when you renew that calling that rests upon your life, the grace, the peace, the purpose, the power that you walk in. And so we want to say thank you to you for all the service that you give, so often unseen. And in Christ's name, I pray over you his refreshing, renewing, and restoring power, that as you commit yourself to another year of service, you may be made new and have the privilege of seeing his kingdom come around you. So may God bless you. In his most holy name. Amen. Now, if you are about to become a reader emeritus or emerita, please would you remain standing, and if not, please do be seated. We owe a particular debt of gratitude to those who remain standing, and some perhaps who would be standing but don't quite feel able to, for their many years of service, for the things that we've witnessed, the sermons preached, the intercessions led, the times that communion has been distributed, the small groups which have been facilitated, and countless other things. But actually, even more particularly, for the faithful ministry that you have offered behind closed doors, when, as Teresa of Avila might have put it, your hands have been the hands of Christ that others have known, your voice has been his voice that others have heard. So we honour you, and we thank you, and we pray God's blessing on you. Almighty God, you have entrusted to your church a share in the ministry of your Son, our great High Priest. We give you thanks and praise for all those who, inspired by your Holy Spirit, serve the ministry of your church. We thank you for these women and men of faith, who have served and continue to do so as readers and pastoral workers in this diocese. We rejoice with them for the moments when your kingdom has felt close at hand. We pray with them for the places where we would see your kingdom come. We seek your blessing on them today as they enter this new phase of their ministry. May they hear your voice speak over them. Well done, good and faithful servant. And encouraged by your word, strengthen them in their witness to the love and grace of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's express our gratitude in the normal way. What they know but you don't is they also get to come for some drinks and nibbles at Bishop's House afterwards, so we'll say just a bit more, but thank you very warmly and most sincerely. We're now going to be led in our prayers, please.
In fellowship with all who have served God faithfully in this place, throughout the ages, let us make our prayers known to him. Creator God, in Jesus you make your dwelling place among us. He brings good news to the poor, redemption to the lost, salvation to all. Anoint your church with the power of your Spirit. Inspire us to live as your children. Equip us to proclaim the gospel of new life, that the imprisoned may be set free, the sick be made whole, and the dead be raised to abundant new life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless the ministers of your church with wisdom and understanding, and with every good and perfect gift. We pray for those faithful ministers whose example of devotion we follow, and we give particular thanks for all who minister as readers, pastoral workers, and lay pioneers. And today we pray particularly for your blessing on those newly licensed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, increase the number of your servants and pour out your gift of encouragement upon us. We pray for all those who are exploring your calling upon their lives, and ask that you would stir up those who would be gifted as readers, pastoral workers, and pioneers in your church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Give us a voice to cry out with the poor for bread, for justice, for peace. Transform our world with mercy and truth. Let your name be hallowed in every land, and your light shine on all who sit in darkness, as we seek to share the love of Christ with those who do not yet know him. Lord, in your mercy,
Amen.
Give us a patient heart to watch and wait with the sick and infirm, the downcast, the refugee, the prisoner, and the despairing. Let them know the power of your healing and the comfort of your love. Repair their brokenness, renew their spirit, and restore their hope. Lord, in your mercy, send us as comforters to those who mourn, that we may share with them the joyful news of Christ's rising. Help us to follow the good examples of all who have gone before us in the way, that we, with them and all the departed, may know you in your eternal glory. Lord, in your mercy,
Amen.
Give us thankful hearts for your faithful servants in every generation, as we remember all who have witnessed to you in this region and diocese. Rejoicing in their fellowship, we pray for the fulfillment of your kingdom in the words our Saviour gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Before the blessing, may I say two things. Do feel free to stand if you're willing and able. The first is to pick up on that welcome at the beginning. As we gather in this place, it is Christ who welcomes you. And we often find that there are those who realize that there is more here than you might have suspected. We've got about 20 people newly licensed, and they would love the opportunity to explain to you why this is not another job. It's not a club that they have joined, but that Christ has met them and changed their life for the better, and how he would long to do the same for you. So if you feel today that there's been a tap on the shoulder, unlike my friend earlier, it's entirely right to turn round and say, "Oh God," because he's here in this place, tapping people on the shoulder. And the other reason he may be tapping you on that shoulder is because he longs for workers to join him in the harvest field, perhaps with a formal role like these lovely folk that we have celebrated today, or perhaps just with a fresh sense of direction and purpose. Before you leave the cathedral, if that's you, whether you want to talk to somebody, we would gladly do so, or simply find a side chapel to sit and reflect and respond to the God who calls and sends. There are so many beautiful global images of Christ around this place. You will find inspiration and guidance in him. For God, who has called you, is faithful. So may the Father, whose glory fills the heavens, cleanse you by his holiness and send you to proclaim his word. May Christ, who has ascended to the heights, pour upon you the riches of his grace. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, equip you and strengthen you in your ministry. Amen. And may the blessing of God Almighty, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest upon you and each for whom we have prayed this day and forever. Amen.
In the light and peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.